Good afternoon or good morning, everybody. Welcome to the first of today's webinar. We actually have a special guest today, which is great. That's Richard. We're going to have a chat with Richard in a second. If this is your first webinar and you don't know who you're listening to, my name is David. I'm part of the software sales team based out of Copenhagen in Denmark. And as I said, we have our special guest, Richard Boutwell of the USA, owner of blackandwhitemastery.com, and of course his own website, who's going to be working with us in Capture One and so forth today. We'll say hello to Richard in a second. I'll just let you all know that we have a 60-minute session to run with each other. We might need all of that. We might need a little bit less, or we might need more. So we'll see how we go. The important thing is that you are very welcome and encouraged to ask questions throughout the webinar. If you're on your Mac or PC, if you look at the bottom of your GoToWebinar control panel, you'll see a section called Questions. Type a question in there and that will come straight through to me. If you're on your iOS device or Android device, you'll see a question mark icon on the screen. Again, you can hit that and it will come straight through to me. I shall try to sort of feed in relevant questions through to Richard as we go. If there's time, we can have a bit more of an open Q&A at the end. But that's going to be the process for today. I am recording the session too, so don't feel you have to remember everything. You are welcome to rewatch the recording. And that will be on our YouTube playlist, and I'll send you the YouTube playlist in a follow-up email in a couple of days' time. Okay, so that's where we are. Let's say hello to Richard. Hopefully he's there in the background. Richard, are you there? Can you hear us? Yes, he's coming.
Yeah, I just unmuted myself.
Hey, Richard. Nice to have you with us. Thank you very much for spending your time on joining us today. I kind of met you via actually a webinar attendee who'd told me about your website, blackandwhitemastery.com, and then I thought it would make sense to have you here showing our attendees what you do specifically in Capture One.
Yeah, great, thanks. I'm really happy to be here. I've done a little bit of work. Before I get started here, I just want to make sure you can see my main screen. So right now you should see the Capture One, or I'm sorry, the Phase One slide that you started, and now
not
I'm going to switch over.
I'm just going to let me just give you presenter. And then we'll be able to see your screen. So I'm just going to make you the presenter. One second. So in a moment, I'll let you know when we can see your screen. So you should get a pop-up, Richard, that is asking if... There we go. Yep, I can see your
screen. Okay, so you see my Capture One screen?
Yep, I see your Capture One screen. So feel free to carry on.
All right, so first, welcome everybody. I started off doing large format black and white landscapes kind of back in like 2000, 2002. Moved to Pennsylvania to work in the darkroom for two photographers, Michael Smith and Paula Shamley, and I worked as their assistant in the darkroom for about 5 years, fixing prints, toning prints, comparing the smallest tonal differences from one to another for 10 hours a day, 5 days a week for about 5 years. So when we started needing to make some digital prints, I taught myself Photoshop and scanning. So now I do the drum scanning, some digital capture work, but mostly drum scanning and printing from 8x10 negatives. So for my own personal work, it's all mostly landscapes. And I started this Black and White Mastery site about a year and a half ago. And it was to help people make that analog to digital transition and using some of the things that we learned in the darkroom and applying those to the digital technique. So one thing I really love about Capture One is it really has it can provide the tonal look that we see with these large format or medium format negatives in the analog space. So I was only using Lightroom and Adobe Camera Raw. I was just comfortable with the interface, the workspace. And then when I started the new site, I started comparing different raw converters, and Capture One just won hands down. So for a while, I was doing a kind of combined color export from Capture One into Photoshop and doing some black and white conversion adjustment layers there. But this picture you see on my screen now, there was some pretty harsh noise and banding in these kind of the smooth transitions where you see this bit of a rainbow here. And Capture One didn't have that at all, the black and white conversion from Capture One. So that was about 2 months ago, 3 months ago, and I started really playing with the possibilities of doing these black and white conversions in Capture One. So I'm going to give you just a quick tour of my interface here. I set up a custom workspace, which I kind of encourage everybody to do. It's pretty minimal, and that's kind of fits with everything I do here. So I have a library, which I use kind of infrequently, metadata and keywords, which I also use infrequently, kind of never use keywords. And then just this is kind of where my workflow starts, mostly with the exposure tab here. So I keep it pretty bare here. I'm using a Nikon D5300, and that's kind of my car camera, my go-to, like, stop the car on the side of the road, hop out, take a few pictures, and keep going. So what I really love here is the option to start with different initial curves, and you can start to get an idea of what the image needs. So for this, I might just choose a high contrast. It starts with a pretty good, I started working on this earlier. I'm just going to undo all that. So we see the initial raw image here. There we go. There's the initial raw image. So I'll start with the exposure tab and just kind of use the keyboard shortcuts, the tab key to move from one field to the next, and use the arrow keys with the shift button held down to quickly kind of see where these settings need to be. And this is a direct translation from the darkroom, where you'd make one test print that's much darker, one that's much lighter, and same thing with different grades of paper. You'll use like a grade 3 or like a filter 3 in the enlarger, and a number 1 to see about what the contrast needs. So I do this pretty quickly. One thing I really, really love about Capture One is this high dynamic range tool here. It doesn't give you that overly pronounced HDR thing that you might see in some popular photography. It's kind of on its way out, which is a good thing, I think. But I use this to just kind of see where, you know, bringing in some of these shadow details and also the highlights. We have some blown out things way up here in these clouds. So I'm going to use this. It's kind of high there. About 30 to 40. And then the other thing that's really great with Capture One Pro 8 is this natural clarity mode. And most of my things, I start out a little bit on the flat side. So I'll just push that about to 24, and the structure, 10 to 20. It's not very high. These levels and curve settings here, I leave these unedited until I go to the print stage, the kind of final toning, because most of the work I do here will be in the local adjustments tab. So from here, I'm going to just kind of get this, maybe a little more contrast, kind of too much, maybe lower the brightness.
And I think, Richard, I remember you telling me that local adjustments is something you started using fairly recently. Is that correct?
I have a pretty specific adjustment layer and curves layer mask use in Photoshop, and this is almost a direct transition from that into Capture One, where these local adjustments, I use these pretty heavily, and most of the work now I do is in Capture One and less so in Photoshop nowadays, because working with the raw file and the great conversion, you really have a lot more to work with. So from here, let me just back up. I'm going to undo this. So I'm not even going to do my black and white conversion yet. I'm still going to work with the color file. I'm going to tone down some of these blown out highlights in the clouds here, and then I'll start working on some some black and white conversion.
So, just to sort of interject, it was a question from John that you sort of get the color image right before going into the full blown black and white conversion.
Correct. Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's just to get a general balance and see what these colors are doing in the color state. So when we actually go to the black and white, we can if these let's turn that off. If these blues were too dark, it'll affect how this looks in the black and white when we click this enable black and white setting here.
Right.
So
gotcha.
I get it about right. A little balance, maybe a little flat before starting to work with the local adjustments. But from here, I'm just going to make this, and I have this extension called text expander where we type burn, we type dodge all the time. So just hitting a few keys, it'll type it in pretty quick. So that's what you heard there. So this is where I was saying that's working with these local adjustments is similar to how I work in Photoshop with adjustment layers. So from here, any adjustment we make here in exposure or contrast is not visible because it's being hidden by the mask. So the first thing I do, let me just get these back to zero, is go up to this local adjustment I created and invert the mask. And now when we lower the contrast, I'm just basically paying attention to those hot cloud areas that I mentioned. So I'm just going to lower the exposure in those areas, use some highlight recovery. And also, this is where I think the people might not mention this in other workflows, is I increase the shadow recovery also. So if I'm doing any burning in around these cloud edges, it won't be, I'm just going to retain some of the softness of the shadows, the kind of the darker parts of the cloud, so there's not so much of a harsh fall off there, or like a noticeable adjustment. I kind of want every adjustment to be invisible. So from here, these highlights, we can take those down a little bit more, lower some brightness there. I'll go back and re-invert the mask. And so now when I zoom in, the zoom tool there.
So just to that's actually a really handy technique. I hadn't thought of doing that. So by inverting the mask, you can see exactly what that layer mask is going to do over the whole image, and then you invert it back, and then I assume now you're just going to brush in to those areas that you want that effect to happen.
Exactly.
Yeah.
In one of my latest posts, I might be actually the last post on my site on the BW Mastery, I talk about outflanking the print, and it's something that I learned in the darkroom, and that was wrote about 10 or 15 years ago by Michael Smith, the person I've been working for a while. And it's this idea of you can see the entire adjustment across the whole image and how the tonal balance, or not to say tonal balance, but how the tonalities affect the structure of the picture. And you can use that for making these, what I can call these intuitive edits, basically on the fly. So let's make sure we're working here. There we are.
There we go.
All right. And so I'm using let me just click the right click here. I use the kind of my fingers hover over the control option command buttons on the keyboard. And then I'm using a Wacom tablet, which makes this, people kind of, turn off the touch tablet. The pen tablet is kind of awkward at first, but get through those first 2 days and you'll ask like how you ever lived without it. So the gesture of a drawing or sketching is a pretty natural one, and it's hard to do with a mouse. Mm. So I really, really encourage people to use the Wacom tablet and the pen. And just, I'm just kind of hovering around and painting it. I'm not actually touching the tablet yet, but so we're not seeing any effect. But you can just really naturally paint these in, pull up, kind of move this out of the way, see how things are working. So I'm going to start to burn some of this in. I'm going to right-click or control-click on the Mac here to maybe increase the brush size. I'm going to use the auto mask, so it's going to be more, it's going to localize that to these really bright highlights here, hopefully not overlap too much in these softer shadows of the cloud there. So I'm just going to really low opacity and just kind of roughly paint in there. And we're just trying to tone that down so our attention is not unwantingly drawn to this super bright part of this image here.
Do you find that the auto mask works quite well in that situation? I hadn't thought of using it like that, because I guess if the people haven't used the auto mask, like then essentially you're going to be sampling the white cloud, then it's not going to bleed out into the blue area. So that's pretty cool, and we can see that
exactly. So like there is, you know, we're looking here. There's some natural darkness around the edge of that cloud, so we don't want to overlap that and increase that darkness around there. So just kind of quickly here, painting in some of that. I'm not going to go too crazy here because of the time constraints. But these kinds of adjustments do go pretty quick. So, you know, I zoomed in here. A quick way to zoom out is just double clicking or clicking a couple times on the little person icon to fit the image to the screen. Mm-hmm. Now, when I turn the mask back off, I just hit M on the keyboard to turn the visibility of the mask off. We can now click on and off our local adjustment layer. Mm-hmm. And see that we just brought a little bit of detail back in there. If it's too much, we can just go back and increase the exposure, maybe like a 20% or so, increase some of the contrast. But now I'm going to deal with this bright highlight right up here on the top. There's this idea that our attention is brought to the brightest thing in the picture. So I really want to use these bright spots, I want them to be visual elements, constructive elements within the composition, and not these kind of accidental leftovers from, incomplete editing. Which is like we're going to sometimes, I'm not sure what the problem is here, but sometimes the...
it's because you're using the keyboard shortcut, only the square arrow, to make it bigger and smaller. And if you're still in like a text window, then it will want to.
Oh, it won't. It won't recognize that.
Tab or escape out. Yeah. And if anyone missed it, it's important when you're doing this technique is that you have a super low opacity. You're like down to 5 or 6 or something, weren't you?
I generally work, but I'm sorry.
No, carry on.
Right click here. Come on now. If that right click's not working, you can click on this here. And so I have a 5% opacity, if I increase that a little bit. We just don't want too much overlap where the feathered edge overlaps into this. So this is pretty localized right to the center of that tooltip there. Turn that back, the mask back on.
Because I think most people, when they start to dodge and burn, they try to do it at like 100% or 80%, and it simply doesn't work, does it? It just looks
It's much too
totally
harsh,
obvious.
So we're going to just look at that mask again real quick. And it's pretty localized right to that really, really bright area. So I'm going to zoom back out and move on here. So turn that back off. So this is obviously flat. We're not going to stay here. First, before I do anything else, though, I want to start working on our black and white adjustment. So the white balance, I pretty much don't change from the custom one I either set in the camera or leave as shot. We can just click this little disclosure arrow, and that'll go away, and we have more room for the rest of our tools here. So I've customized this black and white tool tab to have the black and white adjustment settings, exposure and contrast. And this is a great part about Capture One, is this is the same exposure adjustment that we see in the exposure tab, just duplicated here. So if we, you know, we can lower some of the blues to give a little more drama to the sky here. If that's creating too much contrast, we can just go back to our contrast setting and turn that down right here. We don't need to go back to our exposure tab. It just makes the workflow a lot quicker.
Less scrolling around for various tools and things.
Exactly. We want to get from one thing to the next with as minimal interruption as possible. So what I'm doing here is, this is a, you know, I'm going to click over to a different image real quick just to show about how these black and white adjustments work. So this is an approximation of the visual spectrum going from the violets to the reds. This is just created in Photoshop with the gradient tool from using the whole range of the the hue spectrum, and then overlaid on top of that is a luminosity adjustment with just a gradient from white to black. It's actually about 5% to 95%. But what I'm going to do here is just show you how some of these tools work. So if we click off of that, we see we can darken these blues. You know, let me undo all this so we can see the native black and white adjustment. And we, with most landscapes, we want to kind of increase some of the yellows and reds and decrease some of the blues and cyans and maybe some of the greens at some point too. And then we can also do that with those violets or the magentas, kind of at the extreme end of that scale. There's hardly anything in the image that'll be down on this end unless you have some kind of flowers that are specifically that color. So this is about where all of my black and white adjustments start for landscapes. And you can create your own user settings by going up here and just save user preset. And I've already made a couple here. But I'm going to just call this like, I'll just overdo my, let's make a yellow filter here. And I'll show you how this differs from the ones that come preloaded into Capture One. So down here you have your built-in presets. And if we look at our yellow, there's a pretty harsh drop-off in this range of tones. And so, I'm sorry. I'm not sure if that stuck.
Yeah,
I'm sorry, I was on the wrong one here.
Yeah.
Yep. So with these user presets, it's a little bit more of a jump here in these blues. So I've created my own based on this hue saturation or hue saturation brightness gradient I made. So I'll just go back to our yellow one that I just created and then click back to the image that we're working on here. So I'm just going to click back to there. So let me load that one I just created, and we can see how that affects this image here. So you saw it, those sticking, yeah. So these get a little darker, the blues here. There's a lot of yellow in these clouds and in the dunes here. So if that's too much, we can lower that. It looks a little flat now, so we can increase that, make it a little more contrasty. The thing I've been playing with lately is using the color balance adjustment here in conjunction with the black and white. Mm-hmm. So if our highlights are starting to look a little blown out, I can click onto this highlight here, make the yellow, let me just unclick this so we can see what's going on. Do you see how the yellows in these highlights are becoming a little more yellow now? I can switch those or kind of make that, slide that up or down a bit. We can change the brightness of those. So when we click on this black and white adjustment, we can have local control of different colors in different ranges of the tonal scale and bring those back to something that's not so blown out. And then we can come back and dodge these lower dunes in a moment. So I'm going to go and pay a little more attention to these blue areas on these extreme edges here. And I'm going to do that by going to the mid-tone section in the color balance tool. Drag this center thing, or we can use the outer ring here. Mm-hmm. But I'm going to drag those into the blues. And you can see if I make the saturation of those blues a little higher, the lower blue setting and the black and white adjustment is causing those to be this increased saturation to actually make them darker. So we can localize that with the saturation or the lightness setting or the lightness slider here. So if this adjustment was become a little too extreme, we could bring that up a little bit. This is still looking a little flat. So the black and white adjustment is about where we want it. I can burn these highlights in the sky a little more, dodge out the dunes, and maybe increase a little more clarity or separation in these clouds. So this is where I do most of my work with the local adjustments here. So just like we did with this really local burn and these highlights here, I'm going to create a new local adjustment. And let me just call this contrast boost. Oops. And then I just hit tab to accept that, and I'll come back up and right-click or control-click on the adjustment layer there, or the local adjustment, and invert that mask. So now if I increase the exposure, it's obviously too much, but I'm just shift-clicking to get a full stop of adjustment there. And I'm going to increase the contrast. So when I'm doing this, I'm only paying attention. I should have mentioned that earlier, but I've kind of been accustomed to only paying attention to the area that I'm going to be working on. So these clouds are completely blown out or too contrasty. I'm almost not even looking at them at all. I'm not even registering them. I'm just looking down at these lower dunes. So increase the contrast a bit, and I'm going to go down to the clarity and crank this up pretty kind of a lot. One thing when I mentioned I was working with exporting this as a color, you know, a very basic color image into Photoshop and using the black and white adjustments in there, these kind of delicate details in the sand in the lower part of this image were not even visible. So I went back into Capture One, increased the clarity and maybe the structure just a little bit, and increase the contrast of that, and then I can go in with a gradient or a brush tool and localize this adjustment to those areas. And here's where, you know, I say invert the mask so you can see where everything's happening. I can use this same adjustment layer here to bring out some of the detail on this this cloudburst here in the center, and maybe some of these upper dune parts. But see how we can use that same layer to dodge out or bring some more contrast in the clouds, the central cloudburst, and maybe not so much in these side areas here. But all this stuff kind of happens on the fly, and without, you know, just kind of like each iteration of this can be a completely new experience or a new approach to each image. So I just went back and kind of without thinking, it re-inverted the mask. We're just going to work from this. So here I'm going to go with the gradient. So I'm going to hit G just to get the gradient tool up here. And it's going to go from mask to no mask. So I'm going to bring it up kind of from the very bottom up into the sky a little bit. We're going to overlap this edge here. And from here, we can grab our brush. I'm going to make this fairly large. Take off the auto mask for now and click that setting. And keep the hardness pretty low. And I'm going to just increase the opacity so we can go a little quicker here. And I'm going to keep the feather. The great thing about this tool is you can see where the central part is and where the feather goes out to. So I'm just going to just paint in pretty roughly right in the center. Drag that out towards the edge a little bit. Lots of little adjustments here, or little brush strokes, and overlapping quite a lot. So if we can click the mask on, we might have to wait for my computer to catch up here.
And I think that's a good technique as well, that there's nothing to stop you editing a gradient mask. It's not locked in. So a gradient mask is just a fast way of drawing that gradient, but you can add to it and exactly. Remove from it as you're doing now.
You know, I'm not sure if that's possible in some other programs. This is another reason why. Like you can, so, you know, I made a little bit too much of an adjustment right here in the middle. I'm just going to use the eraser. Just switch over to the eraser tool here. Make sure I'm still pretty low. Maybe make that a little smaller. And just erase out of the center. And a couple quick little brush strokes. And so we don't have this little bit of a hot spot there. This is still looking a little light and a little soft. So now we can just increase the exposure a little bit and maybe a little more contrast and go back down to clarity and maybe make that a little higher. See if. And so this is a, let me do a little more burning on this left edge, or sorry, dodging out here.
Yeah, I got confused with the terms dodge and burn because I wasn't quite sure how it related digital. So I ended up just saying lighten and darken, and then that way I didn't get confused. So.
Make lighter, make darker.
Yeah, make lighter, make darker. Exactly.
Is how you can use burning to increase contrast or burning to lower contrast. There's so many options now that.
That's true.
In some ways, the old terminology, or, you know, the darken terminology doesn't exactly translate. I got a little bit of a hot spot there, so I'm going to erase that out a little bit. So, you know, I don't want to take up too much time here doing these kinds of local adjustments, but this is my basic workflow, is one or two local adjustments and use those in multiple parts of the image. From here, I might go back and do a little extra burning. Right in this cloud area. So we can use, instead of right-clicking and making the brush size larger or smaller, we can use the bracket arrows. Oops, I want to be burning here. The brush. So I'm not going to go too much further because I'm not sure how this time is going here.
Done 30 minutes, so you're halfway
through. So I'd also like to use a different image with a completely different range of tones. So why don't I just get that about right? And now, so let's say that this is done. I created one earlier, and this is the final outcome, the one I created earlier, where I can just click back to it real quick. I made some extra sky separation with this layer. Dodge the foreground quite a lot more and increase the contrast a bit more. Another sky layer where I did a gradient, you can click on that. Did a gradient on the sky and erased certain areas that were a little, like you say, you erased this highlight area here. And then I have a highlight burn like I did earlier. An interesting thing I didn't know until somewhat recently was, okay, we have all our adjustments and we can click off of each one to see the original. But that's kind of tedious. So what I discovered, and this is not a new discovery, it's just new to me, is if you hold down the Alt or Option key and click the arrow button, you can see the before the adjustment layers. And then unclick that, and then you see your final version here.
Yep, that's very useful.
So so this is, let's say, finished. I can go back to the Exposure tab now. And this is where I'll use levels and curves. So let's say this is getting ready to either be exported to Photoshop to do a little more, maybe luminosity masking, or some additional very selective adjustments using like the quick select tool or something like that. I generally don't do much with levels, but I'll use the curves tool. So just kick this disclosure arrow there. And we can use, this is something I detailed in this blog post, the most recent one. Right-click the curve point, and we can click in a part of the image, a tone in the image, and then it creates a control point in the curve here, and we can drag that down, and things could start getting a little darker. We still have the tool selected, the selector tool here, and we can let's drag that off of there. Click maybe something in these midtones to highlights here. And then we just drag this point in the curve back up to get a little bit more of a final version here. Where I do use levels, and let's assume this is going to be ready for printing here, where I use levels and something that people might not consider is the exposure warning tool up here. It usually sits over on this right-hand side of the menu bar up here.
Correct.
Or the toolbar. But I moved it over here so everything's in one spot right above all my other tools. This exposure icon, if we have anything that's clipping, it'll show up as red or blue. Those are user selectable. And that'll just show us if we're using something where we know the shadows will start blocking up at like 95-98%, we can adjust the exposure warning. We can go to the custom, we have to go to preferences.
Yep, that's right.
We go to exposure warning. And see, as I have this set up, the highlights to be nothing brighter than 253. So it's just a little bit off of paper white. It's how I mentioned that our eye is drawn to this brightest thing, and if we have this paper white, we're going to be going right towards it. And the shadows, I have some profiling things for printing that that don't block up between 95 or 98% and 100% black. So I just want to make sure nothing, not nothing, but that there are no large areas that are completely blocked up, and our printing completely black here. So I have my exposure, my shadow warning, and this is an option you can click on or off, to set to one. So with those set, another point I forgot to make earlier, but since I have this the preferences open here, under appearance, most people, and including me, we edit with this medium gray background here. And that can fool us into thinking that these things here are really blown out, or there's like much more, that there's the proper amount of contrast in like these dunes or these midtones. But when we put a, go back to preferences, when we put a white border around our things here, and you know, if we're using a white mat or white paper, you can see this is way too flat still. So so then we'll go back to our curves or our levels at this point, and I'll just increase the white point and maybe increase the black point a little bit. And I still have the exposure warning clicked. So we can, if I start going too high, you can see where things start blocking up there. So I'm going to take that down to where I see very little blue.
So what's the reason for not just always working with the white mask, or
there can be a bit of glare coming off of it, and right. Like I wear glasses and I can see the, you know, if I had dirty glasses, it's a little it gets a little distracting, yeah. So I keep that fairly you know, I don't want any blown out highlights, so just kind of bring this to the very kind of the point where, you know, those are starting to blow out. Now we have our red exposure warning here. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to just back that off a little bit. And here, if we decide that, like now this contrast in these clouds are way too high, we can go back to our color balance editor. I'll go to the shadows and lighten up the blues and the shadows, and you see how this thing here on this right hand side just lightened up a bit, and so did the shadows down in the extreme shadows where most of the blue scale is. And if we increase the saturation there and the lightness, we tone back some of that, those the high contrast drama in those areas. From here I might go back and burn in this make these highlights in this cloud a little darker, because that's now the brightest thing in the image and we're kind of really attracted to there. The other way we can approach that is maybe make a new adjustment here, and I'm going to just dodge out some of these clouds on the left edge, and you know, I didn't do this invert mask here, I just kind of went forward here, increase the contrast there, maybe lower the exposure just a little bit, maybe some shadow recovery. And when I go back to re-invert that mask, and with the brush tool, just bring in some highlights here on this left edge. And that's just it's a darkroom-based technique of just balancing the picture tonally rather than with actual objects. And I might just do a little more in these dunes here on this left edge. So that's my basic workflow, and all images kind of followed that format there. So here, let's assume we're ready to go to print. I have these process recipes. I keep these fairly. I took out quite a lot of them. I had that set on sRGB. We should have maybe had that clipped on TIFF 16-bit Adobe RGB, and this is where. Most of the black and white printing is done in a gray gamma of 2.2. It's where most of, like, if you're using an Epson auto black and white or advanced black and white setting, they'll be mapped to a 2.2. There's the program I use is Quadtone Rip, and I've made custom black and white inks. That's dedicating printers to black and white inks only, taking out the colors and just adding more dilutions of gray inks. So for that, I use this grayscale 16-bit. The reason I don't keep this option clicked the whole time is you'll see that if we go back to a different image, that since Capture One soft proofs in real time, our gray gamma 16-bit 2.2, I'm sorry, It was a little out of order. But that's being applied to all the images, and we can't see what's happening, you know, if we click this black and white adjustment off. Oh, you know, I'm on the wrong image here, I'm sorry. If we turn this off, we're still in black and white, and we can't see what the color image is doing. So all the editing I do originates in this Adobe RGB, so we can see what the color is doing first. When I go to output, I'll switch that to the grayscale 16-bit TIFF that I created. And this is just a TIFF printing with 16-bit, uncompressed, no compression in the TIFF file. I don't need that. We use this gray gamma, phase one gray 2.2. It is G22 is what it says here. And since we're printing with Epson, I always leave this at 360 and scale is fixed. So from here, we can just export. I store files in an export location, so it's a folder within my Capture One export, and I don't keep things in the catalog or the file structure where all the raw files are saved. And you know, file structures and your image management or your database is all kind of a personal thing. And I have one that works for working with film scans as well as digital capture, and so it's specific to me, and I don't expect everybody to use the same way. So I create an export folder and save my things I'm going to print or do additional editing in Photoshop's export folder. So that's where it says output location. It just says output, and you can select the folder that you want. I choose this Capture One Pro export, and then I do a quad tone rip print file designation from the job name, just to designate it as ready to print. So here I can just hit process, and we can either view it in Photoshop, or we could then use a different image layout program for printing. So why don't I do that real quick? We'll just see how this looks.
Hey, while that's processing, Richard, okay. Had a good question from Grant, actually. One on printing, and one on, okay. He said that he's seen that you've used some raw mono files in the past. Does that change the workflow a great deal if you've, like, from a Leica camera or from even phase one camera as well?
Yeah, that's a good question. It's from the monochrome, there's no black and white conversion. So all of the work, let me just switch back to Capture One here. I don't have any of those files loaded. I should have put one of those in here. But there are a few things that don't work. One is the quick mask. Let me just click on the brush tool. The auto mask setting doesn't work.
Okay.
With the monochrome files, and there's no, since it's all monochrome data, all luminance data, the black and white adjustment here doesn't work with because there's no color to.
No, it's based on color data, isn't it? So yeah.
Correct. Yeah. So it does produce a much sharper image, and I've used the camera before, maybe 18 months ago or so, and it's a great camera. I wish I had $10,000 to spend on it, but maybe even the new one. I'm not sure what the new one costs, but it's a great camera, and this is where you would use color filters like you would be using with black and white films. You would use like a green filter to bring up foliage or an orange filter to darken the skies like we did with this picture. But all that needs to be done at Capture, and there's no color adjustment that can be done with those monochrome files after Capture. So it's almost more of a direct translation from working with film when working with that monochrome camera.
Okay, interesting. And Pablo was asking, the image that you went through here, it was a relatively flat image in itself, so not a lot of color variety. Does your technique apply on sort of a very bold, colorful image with more colors and so on?
Yeah, let me turn this off real quick. I'm going to go back to let's get back to the process recipe so we can look at color. Come on, click. So I have it's like something like this in the fall. Mm-hmm. This is still a pretty flat capture. We have some blown out highlights there. So when I work with the, I'm bogging down a little bit here.
Oh, is Photoshop still whirring away in the background as
yeah,
well?
Yeah, it's let me quit this. So here I'm still thinking. I'll just bring up the highlight recovery and some shadow recovery just to bring out some of the detail in these shadows here.
Mm-hmm.
I'll just quickly switch over to the black and white conversion mode if my computer will catch up.
Mm-hmm.
So here, pretty flat. And if we click off of this, we can see like we have some yellows and some light greens. These are more of a, these like right to the right of this topmost right tree, these are some like yellow green leaves, and we have some reds up in here. So I would do a fairly similar adjustment with the black and white setting. Is we can bring up those reds in the background, or we could even drop those pretty far, bring up the bring up the greens, and maybe drop the blues back down. And it does work. Sorry, it's a little frustrating. The computer's not working now. It's a fairly similar technique. And same thing with these. We can go to, something I didn't mention that that is going to be perfect for here. Let's click off this black and white adjustment and go to the color editor. That technique I showed with the color balance and adjusting different tonal mm-hmm. ranges. Our color ranges work similarly with the color editor tool. So I'm just going to click this color selection tool here. And now I'm going to selecting these reds. And we can increase the saturation of these reds here. We're not going to worry about the hue rotation, but maybe darken them a little so we have a little more saturation there. And we can do the same thing with these yellow greens. And then we go back to the black and white. We can do a whole lot more with those. We can slide those, make those a whole lot brighter. We can transition those to a different color range here, and that will, whatever we do here, will affect how the black and white adjustment conversion works.
Yeah, I think that's good advice if you're struggling with a particular tone, that the color editor could be really easily used to influence it as well.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So it does work with these. It's kind of funny that I work in black and white, and most of the original capture is fairly, not exactly flat, but monochromatic anyway, where there's not much, not lots of saturation in what I do here, even when photographing in color. Like this one in New Mexico here, there's some color in there, but it's still pretty, visually dense, or not a lot of... strong graphical element things, and that's just specific to how I work and how I see.
Absolutely.
So we're kind of getting back towards the end. Are there any more questions?
Yeah, also Grant was asking, sort of going back to printing again, do you print from Capture One, or are you always using the quad tone rip, and maybe what's the advantage of the quad tone rip system as well, or what is the quad tone rip system? Maybe some people don't even know what
Yeah, so quad tone rip is it's an inexpensive but very powerful rip raster image processor that takes over. It only works with Epson printers. I'm going to bring up something that you can see here. I'm going to bring up some curves. So we can use what you see popping up on the screen now. I'm going to bring up some piezography curves also. We take, this is a representation of the different color inks in the printer. So So what happens is these are actually six different shades of black or gray ink. So this black one is the pure matte black, and then other shades of gray inks. So what happens is the highlights are being covered by one very continuous coverage, basically, from one shade of ink, and about 20-25% another shade of ink takes over and overlaps that. And so what you get are practically invisible printer dots, even more so than if you're using the original, like the Epson inks. And it just provides for more control over one color. You can actually use the color inks as toning inks and combine different. It's, I'm writing, this is funny, I'm actually writing a book on quad tone rip.
Okay.
And it's, there's so much into it. It's going to be probably over 200 pages doing different workflows and calibrating. But what quad tone rip allows you to do is create these custom media settings specific to your printer, your inks, and your paper.
Okay.
And just provide much more control than you can do with either custom color profiles, custom color ICC profiles, or manufacturer's ICC profiles using a standard color workflow. And it's just, it's a $50 program, but if it was $500, I would still use it. It's a great program.
And is the quad tone rip program designed to work with a particular ink set, not insect, from a manufacturer, or it's for any multi inks?
Yeah, so if you could put ketchup through your printer, they'd print with that too.
Okay.
It's incredibly versatile. So what I've done, Grant asked if I was printing through Capture One, and I had a recent show where I was just making a lot of proof prints, kind of like doing some sequencing and not using the whole layout program. But since my printer here at home is only black and white inks, I will print, like, let's see, I don't do this too often, but you have your printer set up, and this is just like if you're printing through Photoshop or some other. I'm sorry, I have to back up just a little bit. The Mac and PC workflow with Quad Tone Rip are different, so you need to, there's a whole other thing. You'll need to export a TIFF from Capture One and then open that in a Windows GUI that is specific to Quad Tone Rip. On the Mac, you can print, it's part of the printing system. It shows up in your, like if I go to print settings, it would show up just like, I have my printer turned off now, but it will show up as a printer, and we, in the quad tone rip setting down here, we can choose, I have lots of curves in here, testing for the book, but we can combine three different, so let's say we were using color inks here. We could have one that was set for a warm tone, a curve 2 for selenium, and a curve 3 for like a neutral. And I'm just going to pop. This is just an example to show you how this works. This is a little, quite a bit off topic, but interesting.
Yeah, definitely.
So we can do a split toning with our different color setups here. So in the highlights, I could have maybe 70% of this, like if this were warm selenium and neutral, like 50% warm, then we can slide these guys around and do a split toning, and the driver, the rip, will control each of those. I popped up this, I don't have curve view open now. It'll combine different curves here and make the linearization perfect. So I use one with three inks overlaid with one with six inks. It'll combine those and make a perfectly linear print, assuming that the profile or the media settings you created were linear. So it's a very powerful tool, and I've been using Quad Tone Rip since maybe 2007-ish, and the more you work with it, the more you learn. So
it's quite a steep learning curve, I'm guessing, from what we've seen so far. Is there enough sort of preset settings or basic settings that still make it worthwhile in exploring?
Part of what I do is controlling everything, but there are quite a few user settings that, presets that are made for lots of the popular papers. And The piezography, you don't even need to make your own curves or profiles. Those come preloaded when you buy the inks. Or
Okay.
not when you buy it, but when you install the Quantum Rip, lots of the piezography profiles are preloaded.
Okay.
So the printing here, it's pretty basic here, but it's just like the printing would work from Capture One, in where you would we're going to send in a oops I've got this set on the wrong process setting we're going to send in a gray gamma 16-bit TIFF. I prefer printing a 16-bit. I printed some things where in 8-bit where there was noticeable posterization in these kinds of transitions here, like in these soft clouds to these dark clouds. So everything I do is printed with 16-bit. With color, it might not be as bad because you have three different, the RGB is creating overlapping gray points. But with grayscale and printing with these quad tone rip, I prefer printing with 16-bit. So we go back to, oops, I'm not export, cancel. We go to print. Color profile is managed by a printer because we're using those quad tone rip curves.
Mm-hmm.
And all these, we can direct people, I guess, to the webinar on printing that you did a few weeks ago or maybe last month that that show more how all these things work. I'm not going to go into it here because we're running out of time.
Sure. But it's interesting that you can utilize the quad tone rip from Capture One. So I didn't realize
yeah,
that.
Exactly.
I thought you'd, the fact that it shows up as a printer, that's pretty neat. So yeah, that's interesting.
So there are, I don't have a, on this Mac here, I have a virtual machine for Windows for showing people how to use Quad Tone Rip, but I don't have that loaded here. So, I exported a TIFF earlier of this. We can use these third-party layouts. I'm just going to open an image real quick, or open a recent image. We can pop an image in here. This is also created by this, this print tool. We can, in the follow-up email, I'll provide links to these things that people can download.
Yeah, that would be great. So in any of these things that we've spoken about, links to that would be fantastic. Oh.
So you can print from directly from Capture One. I prefer to print through this print tool. On the Mac, and you can lay out multiple images here. I could open up another and pop it in here, but it's the same thing. We go to Quad Tone Rip. I have this the color version and then the Quad Tone Rip version of the same printer, and choose our curves and print with or without color management. That's kind of the great thing about this print tool is it's designed for allowing you to choose if you want to print with color management for doing your profiling process, all this stuff with Quad Tone Rip uses a unmanaged color at first, and then you can choose to do a color managed workflow after you do your linearizations. So, we're just about out of time. Any other last questions before?
Yeah, it's probably a big question, but
okay.
we didn't speak about sharpening as such. Do you sort of have any recommendations for that, or because that's
topic. Kind of moved straight on from black and white into the adjustment layers. So yeah, my preferred sharpening is leave this basically alone.
Okay.
Whatever the default one is, I might lower the threshold to zero.
Mm-hmm.
Keep the radius between like 0.5 and 1 and the amount between like 160 and 200 depending on what your image is like and how big your sensor is and all that. The noise reduction, obviously depending on your ISO settings, I prefer to keep this way down because Capture One does such a – I know I'm kind of gushing over Capture One here. But,
that's fine. That's fine.
Yeah. What do we call it? Demosaicing is so great that there's hardly some of this noise you might see here, and that was just updating, is from some of the color conversion. That's where I might go back in and kind of smooth out some of that color conversion. But I crank the detail up and then the noise reduction fairly low. And if I need to, if we had blow it up and see this at full size, I might increase it a bit. I haven't used film grain too much, but in things where like, there might be some noise or some posterization, when it might not even be posterization, it's just the way this, excuse me, this naturally falls off. I use a fairly low, I like to use either the tabular grain or fine grain. Keep pretty low and intact. So just because format foam contact pruning, and I want these to be shown very consistently with those. So I don't use, if you're using like a Leica and Tri-X and you want to show things made with visual, it might be a better option to use some of these silver rich and crank the granularity a bit, maybe a bit more. But I know we kind of dived off topic from sharpening. I have a pretty specific sharpening workflow in Photoshop, and I usually export to Photoshop, do my sharpening workflow there, and then print into, save as a TIFF, and then print into print tool. When I have been printing through Capture One, when I go to the print setting here, there is in printer this sharpening setting here. Mm-hmm. It's under the resolution. I use 2880 always, and I don't turn this up very high. You know, one of the telltale signs of a bad inkjet print is something you can see visible halos or over sharpening. Like it's what I like to call it is a roundness of, you want it to be sharp, but you still want the tones to be round. And if you crank that sharpening up, you can get a grain granular or speckled or like of a, what's the right word? Like almost an etched look, which might be great for some types of work, but for the kind of work I do and what I'm used to, I don't like it. So I keep the sharpening fairly low and just use those clarity settings and the burning and dodging for any like quote unquote creative sharpening.
Mm-hmm. And that sharpening slider in the print dialogue, it's kind of additional to what's already in the image, and there is no sort of magic number for it. It depends on, as you said, your personal preference, how big the image is, the type of printer. There's, you know, we can't say it has to be 25, 50 or 75 or whatever. It's the sort of thing, as you would do in the dark room, you try out a few different settings and see what looks best, basically.
Yeah. So let me just go back one real quick to this sharpening. The reason I leave this fairly low here is because this is about a good amount for what we'll call import sharpening. Then when I go to export as a TIFF, in these file adjustments here, mm-hmm. I do not click the disable sharpening because I want what I see in Capture One to be translated into either print tool if I'm going to print multiple images, or into Photoshop if I'm going to do more work. I don't want to undo any of that work I've already done.
Sure, sure. And it is a good option if you did want to sharpen in something else. Then, you know, you could disable sharpening there and then do it that way if you wanted to.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yep. Great. Well, sadly, Richard, I think we're pretty much out of time. It's amazing how quickly an hour flies past, that's for sure.
Yep. Yeah, and you know, these things are, you know, once you crack the surface, they're so, like, you can dive so deep. So I'm going to keep writing about these kinds of things on my blog. I've got maybe 20,000 words of posts ready to go. So things just need to be edited and screenshots made, and new things will be coming out all the time.
Great. And then you'll supply us with some links, and then everyone can look out for the follow-up email, which will come to the email address that you registered with. So just check it doesn't go to junk or whatever. And that way you'll be able to follow Richard. I'm just going to steal the screen sharing from you, Richard, for 1 second.
Okay.
Because I just want to show people next week, if I can get that up. You saw Richard doing a little bit of bit of with local adjustments work. So next week, you've just got me, I'm afraid, no guest, but it'll be concentrated purely on local adjustments. So if you hadn't tried that in Capture One and want to see exactly how that works, then we can spend all of next Wednesday, September 2nd, on doing so. And I've actually learned some things today from you, Richard, so I'm going to use those as well, especially the invert trick.
Fantastic.
That's really handy. So you're contributing next week anyway, even though you're not there itself. So many thanks again for your time, Richard. If you want to see it again, we're actually back in a few hours. I can't remember the exact time, but
yeah, maybe 4 hours.
Yeah,
about 4 hours from now.
4 hours, 4 hours time for a rerun. So if you want to watch again, you're more than welcome to register and come back again if you wish, or watch the recording. That's going to be also listed in that follow-up email you'll get in a couple of days too. So it's a goodbye from me. Thank you to Richard. And
Thank you. Thanks for everybody for coming in.
Yep, it's a pleasure. And we'll see you later. Cheers, Richard. Take care.
Bye.